Good morning. On behalf of Organizing Committee of Jyothidev's Professional Education Forum, once again, a warm welcome to you all to the second day of JPEF Convention. Today, the morning session, we are beginning with the topic on tuberculosis. And for this topic, we have a prolific speaker, Professor Dr. Jayant Panda from Cuttack. He is a member, Faculty Council, Indian College of Physicians, member, Executive Committee, RSDI, Diabetes India, and he is the academic member of Academic Council, Sambalpur University, and he has more than 60 national and international publications. So, now I would like to invite Dr. Jayant Panda to discuss on tuberculosis in diabetes.
Good morning, everyone. Respected Dr. Shankar, my chairperson, my friend Anush, Jyothidev, Sunita, and the esteemed delegates of the conference. It's a privilege to be here. First time I came to the city of Thiruvananthapuram, and to attend this heritage meeting of Jyothidev's Professional Education Forum and the fourth convention, I must thank the organizing team, especially Jyothidev, for this legacy of spreading the education in the country, because every time we receive a GM from his center, and always he is into teaching and discussing things. And yesterday only I was telling him, you have an inherent passion for teaching, and that encourages many to learn, and more such resource persons are required in the country at present. So coming to the topic, all of you know the tuberculosis is common in our country, so also diabetes. Being physician, we have an interface of infectious diseases like tuberculosis, like HIV, like malaria, pneumonia, and many others. And not only we see diabetes, we see a host of patients in a mixed population, and only we can give justice to this interface, because India has an epidemic of tuberculosis as well as diabetes merged together at this juncture. So I'll name it a double trouble, and many others have designated this, because we have a challenge of both coming together. In next 17-18 minutes, we'll see how one compounds the problem of the other. We'll see the diabetic and tuberculosis pathophysiology, the epidemiology, the severity of the disease, and the outcome management, and we'll see how one synergizes with the pathophysiology of other. All of you know that tuberculosis and diabetes are currently in a state of convergence of two epidemics. The prevalence of diabetes has increased in countries endemic with the tuberculosis, like that of ours. And the tuberculosis in diabetic patients has become a provocative situation in public health and clinical medicine. Even though link between the diabetes and the tuberculosis has been recognized since centuries, the first report dates back to 1027 AD at Rome, that diabetes is associated more with tuberculosis, more than 1000 years ago. And still it's not considered an important complication of diabetes. And I was browsing the Harrison's Principle of Internal Medicine, which is all of us follow, the 19th edition, and it still doesn't emphasize tuberculosis in diabetes. In the list of complications, they have only put tuberculosis under the infection in a very short heading, and the association has not been given at all. So what I'll tell you in the next few minutes is the CDC description, the Center for Disease Control description of the nexus between tuberculosis and diabetes, which tells the people with diabetes on being infected with tuberculosis have almost two times higher risk of remaining culture positive, 3 times higher risk of progression to active tuberculosis, 4 times higher risk of relapse after completing treatment, and 5 times higher risk of death during tuberculosis treatment. This is what CDC concludes, and you can know the association from that. And the burden of tuberculosis and diabetes, you will see, you know about the diabetes mellitus, which is projected to be double by 2030, and tuberculosis, almost 2.2 million cases out of 9 million cases worldwide. 1/4 of the global load of tuberculosis is in India. It's a country with high tuberculosis and high diabetes, and the combination of two epidemics is going to be catastrophic for a developing country like us. If you see the pathophysiology, in a poorly controlled diabetes, it can lead to multiple complications, and in TB association, there is a direct factor like related to the hyperglycemia and cellular insulinopenia, and there are indirect factors like impaired macrophage and lymphocytic function. This is one of our patients with CNS tuberculosis, and you can see the dilated ventricles and the infarction because of the vasculitis. Here is a tuberculoma, and this is all complications along with the meningitis, and the patient is suffering a diabetic and tuberculosis. The hypoglycemia directly aids the colonization and growth of the organism, and in insulin deficiency, there is decreased activation of macrophages, decreased hydrogen peroxide production, impaired internalization of the Fc receptor bound antigen, and phagocytosis is affected. So, diabetes might adversely affect the T-cell population, the T-cell growth, function and proliferation, and decreases the interferon gamma. The interferon gamma potentiates the nitric acid dependent intracellular killing activity of macrophages, and it has been proved in the rat models that the decrease in the interferon alpha, interferon gamma, interleukin 12 and nitric oxide increases the susceptibility to the tuberculosis, and this is proved beyond doubt. Another patient of mine with diabetes who has presented with the miliary tuberculosis, who absolutely no chest signs, but a immunocompromised patient, and you know this is very common in diabetes, the miliary. Some studies have shown impaired glucose tolerance tests in the patients with tuberculosis. So the other way around, we know the tuberculosis is common in diabetes. To ask whether diabetes is common in tuberculosis patients, none have confirmed the occurrence of diabetes in a patient of tuberculosis. Studies show 10% of tuberculosis patients are glucose intolerant, but that matches to the community. Similar age matched and sex matched controls are seen in the community. And this study shows diabetes to be strongly associated with tuberculosis, and around 13%, 60 out of 454 patients with tuberculosis had diabetes, and whereas 3.2% of age matched and sex matched controlled had diabetes, the tuberculosis patients. But many reviews reported that diabetes probably precedes tuberculosis and not the reverse. Another patient of mine with hydropneumothorax, which most of you have seen many times. Putting some facts in epidemiology, 42% of diabetic patients have positive tuberculin skin tests. And the relative odds developing tuberculosis in diabetic patients, the several case control study, and ranges from 2.4 to 8.33. These are the different studies in the diabetes as a risk factor for tuberculosis worldwide, and they have demonstrated in different way why a patient is more prone. And there is increased risk because of the relationship of tuberculosis and severity of the diabetes beyond doubt. So in A1C more than 7%, there is a risk of diabetes, which is very common, and many studies have concluded poor glycemic control as a risk factor for the tuberculosis. And in more than 4,600 patients, it has been concluded the A1C more than 7%, 3 times increased hazard of active tuberculosis than the normal counterpart. The cavities, multiple cavities in the tuberculosis, one of my diabetic patients, the severity of disease and the outcomes, these are the different studies which shows the baseline mycobacterial burdens are very high in diabetic patients than in control. And this is another patient with TB lymphadenitis, tubercular lymphadenopathy, and the sputum conversion, the studies show the diabetes and tuberculosis treatment had longer sputum culture conversion times, and they have concluded that although bacillary burden is very high at presentation, is leading to modestly longer time for the conversion, rates of sputum culture conversion are similar to those of the non-diabetic patients in 2 to 3 months. So diabetes confers a 3.9 times increased risk of treatment failure. So even if you are treating adequately, the chance of treatment failure, and the treatment failure or the death was seen almost 41% in the patient of tuberculosis and diabetes against only 13% of those with tuberculosis without diabetes. So these are the different studies on mortality, which again concludes that with diabetes the mortality is more and the outcome is adverse. Another patient of mine who had type 1 diabetic, who had presented with tubercular meningitis, you can see the eye, you can see the paralysis of the ocular knobs. And in management, the WHO collaborative framework for the care and control of tuberculosis and diabetes concludes, the patients with diabetes remain alert to a potential tubercular symptoms. Latent tuberculosis infection in diabetes with poor glycemic control with more than 7% hemoglobin A1C was recommended, and the optimal frequency of testing for the latent tuberculosis in infection, in the background of tuberculosis incidence rate and host factors like immunosuppression is approved by the WHO. In American Thoracic Society recommendation, the diabetic patient with latent tuberculosis infection should be offered the preventive treatment, and routine chemoprophylaxis is recommended given the increased risk of tuberculosis among those with poorly controlled diabetes with monitoring of the creatinine levels. This is another patient of mine with CNS tuberculosis, and you can see a tuberculoma in the CT scan of the brain. Let us see some facts regarding the treatment. The infection are known to worsen the diabetes control, show also tuberculosis infection, and the drugs used to treat tuberculosis might also worsen the glycemia control in the diabetes, because the drugs, antituberculars like INH and rifampicin, they are responsible for hyperglycemia, and anti-diabetic drugs like glibenclamide and glipizide, the bioavailability reduces with antitubercular drugs, that we'll see in the next two slides. The overlapping toxicities must also be considered when co-managing the tuberculosis and diabetes. And currently there is insufficient evidence to support changing the recommended standard tubercular regimens. So we follow the same regimens which is given to a non-diabetic patients, and there is no specific recommendation exists for the clinical case management of the tuberculosis in people with diabetes. And in some settings, consultant physicians, they think of prolonging the duration of the diabetes, which has no evidence to date. There's another patient of mine with tubercular lymphadenopathy and diabetes, and was treated with insulin and antitubercular drugs. Few pharmacological issues to think upon. Isoniazid increases the peripheral neuropathy, and it's recommended the pyridoxine should be given to all patients on isoniazid and diabetic patients as per the WHO guideline. Rifampicin is a powerful inducer of the metabolizing enzyme, the cytochrome P450 system, decreases the bioavailability of the drugs. That's why we prefer insulin to the oral drugs. And the glibenclamide and glipizide, there are substrates of cytochrome P450 isoenzyme, I have already told you. Rosiglitazine is metabolized by largely the cytochrome 2C8, and rifampicin decreases the concentration by almost 65%. The insulin requirement might increase when on rifampicin, and the evidence is required to prove this, though hyperinsulinemia in non-diabetic patients has been seen who are receiving the rifampicin. The another x-ray of a patient of diabetes with tuberculosis, you can see there is tubercular pneumonia at the right lower lobe, and there is a cavitation as well as the infiltration. So varied presentation in patients of diabetes and tuberculosis is seen. the treatment part, the treatment of the diabetes should be continued as recommended, and the careful monitoring is required for the patients on anti-tubercular drugs. Is appropriate doses adjustment of the diabetic agents are essential based on the blood sugar monitoring, and always insulin is the preferred choice instead of the oral drugs. As I have already told you, the oral drug availability is low, that is in one hand. Number two, they also, the anti-tubercular drugs also increase the blood sugar, and as such there is an active infection in the body. So let us put some facts to the future. The question, are we missing tuberculosis in diabetes? Probably yes. Enough emphasis has been laid on the conditions associated with diabetes, but the convergence of two large epidemics has been grossly overlooked. And I'll tell, in a country like India, we have to remember, in any immunocompromised patient, any patient with existing pathology has the potential of incurring another one. The complex relations of tuberculosis in diabetes is now fairly understood. An effective screening program by a nodal agency is urgently needed, and the elaborate recommendation of guidelines should be framed and implemented for the patient of tuberculosis in diabetes, so as for the detection, for the treatment, as well as for the follow-up to prevent the relapse. There are a few unanswered questions before we summarize and end the talk. Are diabetic patients at higher risk of relapse than non-diabetic patients? What is the appropriate treatment duration? Does aggressive management in such patients affect treatment outcomes? And what are the most common preventable causes of death in co-affected individuals? Would screening for and treatment of latent tuberculosis in diabetic patients be cost effective, and should we give the chemoprophylaxis in such patients? So finally, to summarize, tuberculosis and diabetes are two epidemics currently in a state of convergence in our country. Without the implementation of immediate measures, the effect will be catastrophic, especially in our country. And it's now confirmed, maybe many studies show incidence and severity in the tuberculosis in patients of diabetes is very high, and the screening programs and the patient education should be started, and further recommendations on the treatment are required. Thank you for the time. Thank you for the attention. And before I leave, I invite all of you to the our program of RSSDI at Odisha, where our Dr. Jyothi Dev is a faculty. It's there. We are hosting the fourth, our fourth JPEF. We're hosting the fourth RSSDI at Puri next month, on 24th and 25th of the September. We are hosting the API Odisha chapter 11th, 12th and 13th November at SV Medical College, My Medical College at Cuttack, and finally a great event, the National RSSDI at Bhubaneswar. Thank you for the time. Thank you for the attention.
Thanks a lot, dear Jayant Pandat, sir. So now the forum is open for discussion. In your slides, you have shown 4% of treatment failure is there in tuberculosis with diabetes. And one of the slides, again, we saw that sometimes the treatment is being prolonged. So, considering these both two, do you think there is a need of continuing treatment?
Yeah, we don't have any evidence that the treatment failure is because of this short regimen. And we treat for the same duration, the diabetic and non-diabetic patient with anti-tubercular drugs. So few feel that the diabetic patient require treatment for some more time, and they have prolonged the treatment. But at present, there is no evidence to support this concept. But treatment failure is common. As I told you, the infection is common, the relapse is common, the treatment failure is common, and death is common. All are common or more prevalent in diabetics than non-diabetics.
So are you continuing the treatment or prolonging the treatment? In
We are actually following the same regimen like non-diabetics at present, because we have to practice the what are there in the literature, but it requires further study. That's why I have concluded, requires further study to tell whether they require anti-tubercular treatment for a longer duration. But at the time of stopping the regimen, you have to assess whether the patient is adequately out of the problem. And even if he is out, there is chances of relapse.
Jayanta, we all agree that this is tip of an iceberg. We are missing the diagnosis of tuberculosis in diabetes patients. And in the last 1 month, we had two instances. One patient had a tuberculosis of the spine, and another patient had an ileocecal tuberculosis. And the latter patient, the only symptom he had was a weight loss. And we couldn't make a diagnosis. And we did an endoscopy, and then it turned out to be a ileocecal tuberculosis. So probably the real incidence could be much, much, much higher.
Much, much more.
And
actually,
that could be probably having a direct impact on the control of diabetes for probably 20 to 30% of our patients. And do we have any statistics on the prevalence of different types of tuberculosis? In terms of affecting the organs specific to diabetes, or if you are not having, you are a leader in diabetes in India, are you planning for any similar studies on?
We have from RSSDI, we have already started, and I think Professor Sarita Bajaj has reached, and we have she has started a project on diabetes and tuberculosis. And in our center also, we are doing a project on diabetes and infection, where tuberculosis is a part of it. As I told, there is 41% incidence of tuberculosis in diabetics against only 13.9% in non-diabetics. In normal practice, we tell that nobody should die of fever without receiving a trial course of anti-tubercular drugs. And every diabetic should have a chest x-ray every year to rule out tuberculosis. This is what we read in undergraduate days taught by our teachers. But in practice, there is almost no work from this country correlating these two epidemics, which is urgently required, and only physicians can ensure that problem. That I didn't touch because that is out of the scope of the topic. You are right. The tuberculosis and HIV is another interface, and they have synergism. Almost 60% of the HIV patients, they have tuberculosis, and almost 60% of tuberculosis patients, they have HIV in India. It's a bigger synergism than diabetes and tuberculosis. And in our series now, in this number of patients what you are seeing, almost 1/3 of the patients have tuberculosis and HIV both, and in them the problem is still compound because the antiretroviral drugs again increases the insulin resistance, and there are many complications of diabetes, complications of tuberculosis, as well as the complications of HIV being compounded.
Bladder TB as well as ileocecal TB in patients with diabetes.
Yeah, actually, as Jyotidev was asking, we don't have any study from this country telling about the extrapulmonary tuberculosis, especially, as you told, the renal tuberculosis, the skin tuberculosis, other tuberculosis. I show a photograph of the lymph node tuberculosis, which is very common extrapulmonary site, and we had a few patients. But regarding how common in diabetes is not done in this country, but the world literature tells the atypical sites or the extrapulmonary tuberculosis is more common than the non-diabetic patients.
Here in Kerala, 44% of TB patients are diabetic. Studies are done in our department, health service department, and all patients are treated with insulin.
So, all?
Yeah, all patients. Insulin is also given along with the TB treatment. And all diabetic patients are also screened, at least in some higher hospitals.
That's very important.
Yeah.
Actually, we have to keep in our mind that when you see diabetics, we must screen them for tuberculosis.
It's being done in major hospital.
At detection and also every year. Yeah. Because they can...
See, the problem, you know, a diabetic patient will not have the symptoms of TB, you know, especially
fever and...
No cough.
Yeah.
No cough. And now we take only X-ray, then only we see some lesions are there.
Exactly.
Then we send it the sputum for...
Presentation is atypical.
Atypical, quite atypical.
They don't have fever, they don't have cough, the chest is clear. I showed you an X-ray of miliary tuberculosis, very common in diabetics.
Chest X-ray anywhere, you know, in mid zone or lower zone, the lesions will be seen.
Sir, it's a fact. So we have to suspect tuberculosis and we have to screen our diabetic patients at least once in a year for any latent tuberculosis. That's very important because I showed you very high incidence of tuberculin test positive, and unless you detect in time and treat, the patient may face a catastrophe. So tuberculin test is not very important in our country because of the incidence of tuberculosis, most of us are positive for the tuberculin test. That is what I showed, the incidence in diabetic patients. But you have to see for the presence of latent tuberculosis or any active tuberculosis in the patient by examining clinically and the investigation wise. But tuberculin test doesn't tell much because as such we have a positivity very widely.